लाइव शुरू हो गया था। YouTube লাইভ শুরু হয়ে গেছে। ম্যাডাম ভিসি স্যার জয়েন করেছেন।
ম্যাডাম তাহলে আমরা স্যার আমরা তাহলে এবার আরম্ভ করতে পারি।
আরম্ভ করে দাও। গুড মর্নিং স্যার।
গুড মর্নিং।
গুড মর্নিং। আরম্ভ করে দাও অনিন্দিত, আরম্ভ করতে পারো।
ভেরি গুড মর্নিং টু অল। On behalf of the Department of Economics, Panihati Mahavidyalaya, I, Rakhide, the faculty of this department, cordially welcome everyone to this international webinar. Before starting the program, it will be great help for us if the audience kindly mute their microphone and don't record the program. For any technical help, please write in the chat box. Our technical team will look after the matter. Kindly note that an auto-generated participation certificate will be sent by email. The registered participants are requested to fill and submit the feedback form after the webinar is getting over. The link has already been sent by email, which will become active at 12 noon IST 27 July and will remain active up to 12 noon IST 28 July. Now I would like to request Dr. Anindita Basu Chowdhury, the head of this department, as well as the program counselor, to start off and proceed. Over to you, Dr. Basu Chowdhury.
Good morning to one and all present here. The topic of today's international webinar is Impact of Lockdown on the Higher Education in USA and India. We all aware that at present, the world is facing pandemic situation as the coronavirus is sweeping its way around the globe. Given the nature of the disease, which is highly contagious, the people are compelled to maintain social distancing and self-isolation at home. In this situation, most of the nations have been forced to announce lockdown. This pandemic, accompanied with lockdown, makes our social structure partially paralyzed, and education system is among the worst sufferers. In that situation, it is our primary responsibility to normalize the human life, suggesting the way forwards. And from this point of view, I think this webinar issue is appropriate. Now, we are going to start our inaugural session by inaugural speech by our Honorable Vice Chancellor of West Bengal State University, Professor Bashop Choudhury. May I request you, sir, to deliver your inaugural speech?
First of all, good morning to you, sir. Yeah, first of all, good morning. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Good morning to all of you. I hope that all of you are staying safe and taking all care during this pandemic. Initially, Rathi Deb and then Dr. Anindita Basu summarized the objective of this particular webinar in a very nice manner. I really found in Anindita Basu's presentation a very brief but very focused presentation where she described the importance of the webinar, why this webinar is being organized. In webinar, it is not unlike seminar. Webinar should be, in webinar, the addresses should be very, very brief, to the point, and also should make wide coverage of the subject that is being targeted. And I found in Anindita Basu's presentation that particular thing. She has clearly stated why this is needed, because the social structure has been under threat. And when the social structure is under threat, we as educators also are looking for ways as to how this social structure can be revived. And this revival is not easy for all of us. In this particular webinar, we were also comparing the state of United States of America and India. I do not know why United States of America and India, they are being compared, because in terms of parameters, United States of America and India, they are quite different. They are quite different because most of the people are having smartphones in United States of America. There are many, many good institutions in United States of America which rank among the first 200, 500 of the institutions, as compared to India, where it is much less. And this ranking is not only the scholarship involved, this ranking is due to the fact that they have also been able to create a large amount of facilities in their campuses. So, taken together all these things, when you try to rate an institution having larger facility, an institution having larger acceptability, an institution having larger advertisement and then global studentship, will naturally get good score. So United States of America and India, when you compare, I am afraid that India will always fall back. India will always fall behind as compared to United States of America. But the point is, we need to go much further in order that we can make a difference in this COVID-19 situation, in this pandemic. This pandemic was not known to us for the last 150 days or maybe more than that, maybe 152 days. We are under lockdown. So it is almost 5 months that we are under lockdown. And this lockdown is causing a lot of problems in our society, not only in terms of physical problems, but also in terms of mental problems. The students cannot come to the university and colleges. The teachers cannot come to the colleges and the universities. And the small children cannot go to school. The teachers of school cannot come to their institutions. So it is, it is a very difficult situation. And in this difficult situation, we have to really devise new ways, new methods, new ideas. We have to bring in new ideas. when the situation becomes bad and out of control, when the situation goes out of control in any way, it may be during war, it may be during this pandemic, because this pandemic was not known. I never thought that there will be this kind of lockdown in my country where the population is 130 crores, simply because so many people depend on very ordinary jobs. You know what I mean by ordinary jobs. They have to come out every day to the street in order that they can get their livelihood. Now, this lockdown has put a stop to all of those. And this lockdown has forced them to stay home. Now, have you thought how will they have their food? How will they have their medicine? Will it be possible for them to continue their life? So when you think of all these, you really become anxious. You really become tensed in this situation. I do not know what is the way out. Government is giving subsidy. Government is trying to give ration and facilities. Government is trying to be by the side. But again, the civil society, what is it doing? You know, in Bonga yesterday, an old lady, she was lying for six hours, and nobody was there to help that lady because of the fear that corona may be affecting that the person who will go to give helping hand. So that is basically the situation that the pandemic has caused. We are afraid, and we are afraid because we are mostly thinking about our own lives, and we are not thinking about lives of our neighbors or about lives of our near and dear ones even. So that is basically the disconnect that has taken place. COVID-19 or this pandemic, you know, SARS-CoV-2, they call it SARS-CoV-2. This particular virus has caused a peculiar fear in the mind of people. Peculiar fear in the mind of people because this virus is contagious, as Anindita Basu has so nicely said. It is contagious, number one. And number two is that although the death rate is not very large, the infection is becomes so very difficult, and when the infection becomes difficult, you know, difficult to control, people go for hospitals, and you know, the hospital system also has a fixed number of beds in our country. Although the governments are trying to do the best. Point is, you know, the hospital facility cannot be extended to all the people, because you know, culturally we have known to treat ourselves at home also. It is a part of our medication. We try homeopathy, we try allopathy, Ayurveda, we try different other things, and that is how we have developed. The Western medicine that we are talking about, the fruit of Western medicine only reaches a few even today. So that is basically the situation. The hospital is not having large number of beds that, you know, any number of patients can be accommodated. It is not so. And COVID-19 is putting pressure on all these, including the teacher-student relationship and the institutional institutional work methodology. What is the work methodology in an institution? What was? Students used to come, we used to have a routine, we used to go to class, we used to have practicals, we used to have theoretical classes, and students used to come, they used to do the classes, they used to have home tasks, they used to appear in the examination, and in this manner, there used to be a regularity in the life of the students and also the teachers. Now what has happened? COVID-19 is not allowing you to come out of your house. COVID-19 is putting a stop to your movement. COVID-19 is saying that, you know, put a mask and do not come out, stay at home. So that is what has caused a lot of problem, and we do not know how to overcome this problem. So this new teaching and research methodology that is emerging. Now, again, I will tell you that whenever there is unusual situation because of war, because of human problems, migration, because of natural calamity, because of violence in society, which is undesirable, because of this kind of crisis that is taking place, because of this COVID-19. The social structure and the way we do things, these come under pressure and these become different. And then in this situation, innovation becomes important. What is important becomes innovation. How will you innovate? How will you reach the student? How will you really tell the students about their study? How will you do your examination? How will you take your admission process? How will you conduct your admission process? Admission process is coming, will come. How will you conduct your practical classes? So these questions will gradually come to the colleges and universities. They have already come to the colleges and universities. And that is why when we cannot go along the roads which are known, we have to really explore the unknown. When the roads are not known, we have to explore the unknown. And what is the unknown? This unknown is basically reaching over the sky, reaching over the sky through the net and then through the Android phone. Problem is, it is easier said than done. Benjamin Franklin had said something very interesting. Well done is better than well said. Well done is better than well said. So well done, it is not easy to really do these things in a very nice manner, because only a few persons are having this Android phone. Only in the cities. Think about the person in Bonga, Bushirat, Barachapa, and the distant places, on the borders over there. And there is no signal and there is no internet. Even if they have there is internet, the internet connection is very poor. So those students, how will you reach them? So that is why people are talking about blended system. People are talking about hybrid system. And what is that hybrid system? Hybrid system is basically, you put some material on the web, you do some webinars, you come online and do some classes, you put contact some classes offline, you bring a few students to the college, only a few on a particular day, the other students will be online. Again, the next day, another group of students will come and the other students will be online. And in this manner, you innovate and create a system. And once that is created, there is a telephone call, and this is distracting also for webinar. Whenever webinar is being organized, because I do on telephone, I do on my Android phone, often one telephone or the other comes and then it distracts. So that is what, the new teaching and research method will depend on this kind of transmission across through the internet. So internet must be good. There must be a good smartphone. All the available materials will be sent to the student. And if you cannot send to the students, there must be materials available on your website so that students can get. If still the students cannot be reached, then hard copies must be sent to them. So this is a tall order. It is not easy to accomplish all the tasks in this manner. So that is what, we are discussing, we are deliberating, we are thinking, we are innovating. We are trying to help the student as much as possible. It is not a good situation for all of us teachers also. But the point is, we are trying. And as long as we try, there must be some solution. You must push. And you must push against the wall. Maybe the wall will not move, but at least there will be some attempt to reach the students. When you compare Indian situation with the United States, even the United States is not in a very happy state today, because a large number of deaths have taken place. A large number of people are affected. And even this fall semester that we call fall semester, the fall semester are having online classes. So they are also having online classes, but it is easy for them to do online classes because the internet connectivity is quite good over there, particularly in cities. In the middle of the United States, I do not know what kind of situation exists because I have not been to the middle. I have been to the East Coast, I have been to the West Coast, but I have not been to the middle of the United States. I do not know that place. So the point is, those places where I have been, the connectivity is very good. Los Angeles, San Francisco, Seattle, all those cities are extremely well connected. Seattle is basically the place for Microsoft, Bill Gates' house, and Bill Gates and his associate, their house. And I have been to East Coast, of course, New York and all those places, Philadelphia. They are also very well connected. So there is no problem as such. And the most reputed institutions are located over there. For example, Caltech, California Institute of Technology, Stanford, then Berkeley, then they're all on the West Coast. And in the East Coast, you find Boston, Maryland, and all those places where the universities are also, New York University, all those universities are very good. So the point is, there it becomes easy for them to impart knowledge through this process, through this kind of internet. But when you come to India, particularly with so many affiliated colleges with first generation learners, it is not easy. Think about the first generation learners. What they will eat is a question, and they will study under the circumstances. When the question of eating looms large in their mind, think about it, how they will conduct their study. So it is not easy. So we are still experimenting. We are still trying, and we have to continue to try. Saying that, I must say, there is no substitute to face-to-face teaching. What we do in our classroom, that is the best. Everyone is saying that, you know, that is the best possible teaching. But today, because we are caught in lockdown and we are not in a position to go out, this blended system is being talked about. And again, it is not only internet, but it is blended system, hybrid system. What is the meaning of hybrid? You do conventional and you do non-conventional, new, novel. Conventional and novel. What is conventional? Conventional is what you have done so far. We have excelled. We know how to teach. Novel is something where this kind of online system and platform and this kind of virtual classes will be done. And that is easy for social science. That is easy for Bengali, English, history, but not easy for subjects like physics, chemistry, where there are large number of experimentation. And since I am from science and technology background, I personally feel the way we do practicals, that is also not adequate during our normal situation. We need to do practical when you are studying, teaching the subject. In our case, what we do, we teach the subject in the first semester, we do the practical in the second semester. We do the class in the course in the first week of August, and we do the practical in the third week of November. By that time, the student has forgotten. That is not the way. When you do the class, you do the practical at that point of time. Or you do the practical with little amount of theory. Try to understand what are the problems. And then go back to the theoretical class. Try to see the difference between the practical and the theoretical. Try to understand why practical is not matching with the theoretical thing. Why there is a gap in information. Why there is a gap in experimental result. Why there is error. And why that error will happen in the actual circumstances, because you are not getting an ideal situation to do that practical. These are some of the things that the students must learn. I will end by saying to the students, in offline mode of education, remember, this is for the students. In offline mode of education, the teacher's role is very important because you are getting the teacher there. You are asking the teacher, madam, I am not understanding. Sir, I am not understanding. So because sir, I am not understanding, sir is coming and helping you. But on online mode, you are getting the teacher for a very brief period. Because you are getting the teacher for a brief period, for a few minutes, not even hours, maybe half an hour, maybe 40 minutes you are getting your teacher. Your role as student is very important. Your role as student, your responsibility as student is very important. Why am I saying this? I am saying this because if you do not study and do not understand what you are studying, you will fall back. So the responsibility of the student on online teaching is much more as compared to the offline teaching. In offline, you can always go to the principal, oh, madam, I am not getting this, oh, I am not doing that. It is easy. But on online mode, you cannot get the principal, you cannot get the teacher. So on online mode, the responsibility of the student, accountability of the student to understand and to appreciate the subject is much more. Now, when I say this, I cannot really expect that all the students will be equally responsible. There may be some amount of irresponsibility. So here comes the character building, value education. You must do value education. On offline mode, you will do value education. Online mode, you will do value education. There should be some courses on value education, how to concentrate, how to do your classes. So think about it. In 40 minutes, a particular chapter is being taught. Now, can you, I think Anindita Basu and Rakti Dev, they're all listening. Can you complete a particular chapter in 40 minutes? It is not possible. So you need to give good number of references. And those references need to be studied by the students. And they will raise questions. Once they study the references, they will have some questions in mind. They will send the questions to the teacher and the teacher will answer back. So in this manner, the entire education system will continue. Although we cannot come near to each other and see face to face, we are always connected in this virtual world. And that is what this online education means. And that is what we need to make a creative approach and create a platform where we will be in touch together always. So that is what I personally feel. I hope that this particular webinar will be greatly successful, organized by the Panihati Mahavidyalay. I thank the principal and pay my gratitude to her, pay my respect to her. I pay my respect to Anindita Basu and Rapti Dev for their initiative in conducting this webinar and getting me over here in the early in the morning because, you know, I sleep late, so I get up late. But today, Anindita Basu has made sure that I get up early in the morning and remain prepared for this webinar. So, Mukti Ganguly also, although Mukti Ganguly does not know, she has forced me to get up in the morning today. So, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. I think I have told you something. It is not only teacher's responsibility. It is also the student's responsibility that matter. I have a boy who is doing these online classes today. And the way online classes are being held in his institution is something remarkable. Online classes are happening for 4 hours, 5 hours, and my boy is going to a separate room and sitting with computer and with internet connection and concentrating on the lecture in a very nice way and preparing the project work and sending them on a mobile phone to the teachers and are doing a very great job. I see my boy is very, very good in studies. So I am really happy. So the point is everyone will not be that gifted. I cannot expect from all the students of my community that everyone will be equally talented in study. They may be talented in something else. That is the problem in our higher education system. That, you know, if someone is a painter, he has to be a graduate. If someone is a very good artist, he has to be a BSc graduate. You know, we force them. We do not cultivate the way Rabindranath's education that we have not been able to cultivate. Rabindranath wanted that. Rabindranath created Ramkinkar Baige in his system. Rabindranath created Nandalal Bosu in his system. We have not been able to do that. In our system, everyone will come and get a BA degree and go. Everyone will come and get a BSc degree and go. Everyone will come and get some become degree will go. And then year after year, they will try and they will not be able to get that degree. That is not the purpose of education. The purpose of education is basically to get enlightened.
So all those factors must be kept in mind. And the students who are listening to, again and again, I am telling you, it is your responsibility today. You have to understand, you must be responsible. You must be accountable. If you are not responsible, if you are not accountable, even if Panihati Mahavidyalaya organizes this webinar, it will not be successful. You need to be, the principal is trying, Anindita Basu is trying, Rapti Devi is trying, teachers are trying, everyone is trying. But this attempt will not be fruitful until and unless you become receptive about the problem. Receptive means you receive. You have to receive the signals. You have to receive the learning. You have to receive the different ideas that are being propagated. And blended mode of education. Not only now, what we are doing on online mode, again, you know, I'm talking much. Dr. Basu, do I stop now?
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I'm indeed grateful to you for giving me this opportunity, because there are other speakers, and again, webinar is something where it should be abridged and it should not be very large. I understand that, but the point is, you know, there are many ideas where which come. And yes, today, sir. Because I got some time, I started speaking a lot. So the point is, you know, I will stop now. I send my good wishes to all of you. I inaugurate this seminar with a lot of humility, because you were giving me an opportunity to do that. And all of you stay safe, take care, follow the social distancing norms, use mask and use gloves, and try to be, you know, as safe and as secure as possible. But do not be afraid, because, you know, there is no point in being afraid. Face life as it comes. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your motivating and informative speech. Now, I am requesting our Honorable Principal Madam, Dr. Mukti Ganguly, for her welcome address. Over to you, no. Madam.
Okay. Hello. I would like to congratulate Dr. Bashab Choudhury, Vice Chancellor, West Bengal State University, for his valuable presence and valuable speech in spite of his busy schedule. I would like to express my deep gratitude to Dr. Sudipta Roy, Associate Professor of Finance, University of St. Francis Joliet, Illinois, USA. I would like to congratulate Dr. Mohananda Kanjilal, Associate Professor of Economics, Jogesh Chandra Choudhury College, Kolkata, Guest Faculty, Department of Commerce, University of Calcutta. I would also like to welcome the Department of Economics and IQSE of Panihati Mahavidyalaya. I would also welcome all participants. The first phase of lockdown was announced by Prime Minister in India on 25th March 2020 for 21 days. Coronavirus pandemic has significantly disrupted various sectors in India. The country temporarily shutting down schools and colleges. There is an uncertainty when schools and colleges will reopen. In India, about 32 crores learners stopped to move college and all educational activities brought to end. Despite of this, the higher education institution have reached positivity and managed to ensure the continuity of teaching and learning with some tools and techniques during the pandemic technology, and may play an important role like study from home and work from home. In India, higher education institution has adopted online teaching method. The people residing in rural areas are still very much deprived of technology and thereby hampering the case of online education. Various activities like admission, examination, entrance test, competitive examination are now fully postponed. The higher education institution have started conducting orientation program, induction meeting, counseling class with the help of e-conferencing tools like Google Meet, Skype, YouTube, Facebook Live, WebEx to provide to support the students. Academicians got acquainted with the technological methods and improved their research. Secondly, severely affected the educational assessment system. MHRD and UGC launching many virtual platforms with online e-books. Various students from India took admission in abroad like USA, UK, Australia, China, German, Latin America, and these countries are also badly affected due to COVID-19. Maybe there is a possibility that students will not take admission there in future, and in the long run, there will be a decline in the demand for international higher education also. The higher education institution face multiple hits, including the probable loss of foreign students. A country's political policy and economic outlook with the world's best forward-looking analysis plays a vital role in this situation. Education system in US is considerably more flexible. The Indian education standard is considerably higher than that of other countries. Today we have got Dr. Sudipta Roy, she is Associate Professor of Finance in USA, and Dr. Mahananda Kandilal, Associate Professor of Economics in India. So we will get ideas about higher education after lockdown and financial policy of the two countries. So think all participants will enjoy the webinar, hope the successful webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for your valuable opening remarks.
Dr. Basu.
Yes, Dr. Basu,
I am Vice Chancellor speaking. I just would like to give my regards to the teachers who are coming to deliver lectures over here from US and from other colleges.
Yes, and the collaboration
that you are getting, I am indeed grateful to the institutions for the collaboration that they have, that you have been able to achieve. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Have a good day. Thank you.
Now, I am requesting our Honorable IQAC Coordinator, Dr. Mohsina Roy, to deliver her welcome speech. Over to you, Dr. Sina Roy.
Am I audible, Anindita?
Yes.
Thank you, Anindita. Hello, everyone. A very good morning to you all. On behalf of Internal Quality Assurance Cell, IQAC of Aniyanti Mahavidyalaya, I welcome you all to this international webinar titled Impact of Lockdown on Higher Education in USA and India. COVID-19 pandemic is tightening its grip every day. The disease due to COVID and its related death has become a cause of concern. Most of the people are advised to remain indoors. COVID-19 pandemic has significantly affected and disrupted the educational system worldwide, leading to the near total closures of schools, colleges, and universities. There is no certainty when they will reopen. The structure of schooling and learning, including teaching and assessment methodologies, was the first to be affected by this closure. So there are so many queries in our mind, and we are eagerly waiting for answers. I think you'd get the satisfactory answer of your queries from our eminent speakers of India and USA, and hope you will be enriched with knowledge through this program. And it will provide you the tool to navigate through and thrive in this really uncertain situation for the educational sector. I wish the international webinar organized by Department of Association with IQAC of Panihati Mahavidyalaya a grand success. Again, thank you to all. Now I would request the convener to continue the program in the next step. Over to you, Anindita.
Thank you, Dr. Sina Roy, for your hearty speech. And this is how we are going to conclude our inaugural session and enter into the main technical part. Let's begin this technical session by getting acquainted with today's eloquent speakers. Today we have two honorable speakers, Dr. Sudipta Roy and Dr. Mahananda Kanjilal. A special announcement to the audience, you can send your queries to the speakers through either chat box or YouTube as well as Facebook Live comment section, which will be discussed in the next session. And please address the speaker's name with the question. Now, let's introduce our first honorable speaker, Dr. Sudipta Roy. Awarded a PhD in the area of economics from Indira Gandhi Institute of Development Research, Mumbai, Dr. Roy worked as an economist at Industrial Development Bank of India and later as a consultant at National Stock Exchange India. After completing MBA in finance, she switched her career to teaching. She taught as faculty at Kankakee Community College in Illinois, United States for 10 years and has been teaching at the University of St. Francis, also in the Illinois, United States for the last 5 years. Dr. Roy teaches economics, finance, statistics at the both bachelor's level and master's level. Apart from her busy academic schedule, Dr. Roy has published her papers in a variety of reputed journals, namely Journals of Development Economics, Journal of Emerging Market Finance, Teaching Statistics, Journal of Business Cases and Applications, Journal of Higher Education, Theory and Practice, Operation Management, Education Review, etc. She enjoys doing educational research, especially the effects of goal setting as a motivator for students' performance. More recently, Dr. Roy has been working on the various aspects of the COVID-19 and the resulting switching of learning process to online mode. Today, Dr. Roy is going to share her extensive knowledge on the impact of lockdown on higher education in USA and related challenges and prospects. Now, I would like to request Dr. Roy to present. Over to you, Dr. Roy.
Thank you very much, Anindita.
Welcome.
I think at this point, I will share my presentation and then start. Give me 1 second, please. Audience, please bear with me while I see how to share my screen. Will you please tell me whether you can see my presentation?
Yes.
All right, thank you. Good morning, everyone. At the outset, I would like to commend the Department of Economics and the IQAC at Panihati Mahavidyalay for organizing this webinar on this very important topic of our times. A special thanks to Anindita and Rapti for coordinating, communicating with me and Mahananda for this event. And thank you very much, Dr. Mukti Ganguly, for inviting me to speak. As Anindita mentioned, I teach at the University of St. Francis in Joliet, Illinois. Those of you in the audience today, you are probably directly impacted by the lockdown and its effect on higher education, either in your capacity as an educator or because you are a parent whose child has been studying online for the last 4 months. That so many of you are attending the webinar today is reflective of your interest in understanding the challenges and, more importantly, the opportunities that may come out of this situation. So what I thought I would do here today is start out with my own experience with what is now referred to widely as the emergency transition or the emergency switch. Then talk about, build it up to a slightly macro level and talk about the experience at my university. I'll talk a little bit about surveys that are conducted nationally in the United States and findings that can be drawn from those surveys. Going forward, the lessons that we can learn. And then I would like to conclude with my thoughts on adoption, adaptation of tools and strategies that are used here in the United States in the Indian context. Now, any views that I may express in the process of this webinar, in the process of my presentation, are strictly my own and do not represent those of the University of St. Francis. As Dr. Bashub Chaudhary said in his opening remarks, the experiences and the degree of impact that different countries and even institutions, different institutions within the same country have faced varies a lot. However, there are some things that all institutions share in common. For example, he mentioned conducting practicals for the science courses. That is a problem, that is a challenge, an issue that is faced by educational institutions in the United States, just as it is faced by institutions in India. And in fact, institutions worldwide. So from mid-March onwards, the lockdown has presented challenges for education everywhere. And therefore, what I think is collectively, we can all learn a lot from our shared experiences. And that's why I'm very grateful. I think it is commendable that Panihati Mahavidyalaya has organized this event and provided a forum for at least a case study comparison, if you will, between the United States and India, between my institution, if you will, and the institutions in India. So that's my plan. So let's start out with how did I see or face the emergency transition situation. So here at my institution, our semesters run 16 weeks long. We take a break after 8 weeks, so exactly halfway in the semester. So for us, spring break was March 9th to 13th. That's when faculty and staff get a break from teaching and learning. We come back refreshed for the second 8 weeks of the semester. So March 6th was the Friday when we were wrapping up the first 8 weeks, and there were already early indications that things may change. Several universities in the United States were already starting to announce that when classes resume post-spring break, they would be online. It wasn't yet known for how long they would be online, but announcements were already coming in, so that was the early indication that things may change, and they may change quite abruptly. So March 9th to 13th was our spring break, and as spring break progressed, the city of Chicago slowly started closing down. Large events were starting to get canceled. March 12th was a Thursday, and as I personally was starting to get ready to return to campus, the announcement came that our classes would resume on March 16th, but in the online-only mode. So that's for me how I have to now adjust to the new situation. So the tools and strategies that I would use would determine students' learning experience. This is an abrupt change for them. My students, the undergraduate students who were enrolled in the face-to-face classes, would have to learn to adapt to the new environment. And how their learning experience would be, what kind of learning experience I could offer them, would determine the feedback and the evaluation that they provide. And that in turn would give me lessons or for fall, and in fact beyond fall, for the future. So it was very important that everything be set as right as possible, because suddenly we are all in this situation of a constrained optimization. Suddenly some new constraints have been imposed for us, but we all want to maximize our utility function. So from an educational institution perspective, we want to maximize, if you will, our production function, our ability to continue to teach classes or provide learning experiences similar to face-to-face classes. And from the student's perspective, it is their utility function. They still want to maximize their utility subject to this constraint that classes would now be online. So it was very important that I do my best to ensure a smooth transition. At the same time that we received the announcement that classes would be online, students also received the notification that classes would resume in online-only mode. It is only natural that students would experience a significant amount of anxiety, because this is not what they had signed up for. So the first thing I did was realize that it was extremely important to communicate to students that I would do my best to ensure that their transition was as seamless as possible, and that I would prepare them for the remote learning experience. So several changes were necessitated. The on-campus face-to-face classes would now be replaced by video sessions. I would provide additional supplementary resources online. In fact, I'll talk quite a bit about blended learning that Dr. Bashyap Choudhury also mentioned in his opening remarks. And an important change would be exams would henceforth be online. At that point in the semester, most students still had at least 2 unit exams to be taken online, and of course their cumulative final exams. So for me, I had a significant degree of comfort with this transition, and there were several things that contributed to that. Again, I'll keep making reference to what Dr. Bashyap Choudhury mentioned in his opening remarks. He talked about how the environment, the situation in the United States may be very different from the situation in India. But as I said, I think there is a lot to learn from our collective experiences. And therefore, let's see why is it that I felt comfortable with the transition. Please understand that my experience is different from other faculty's experience. Okay, so I don't speak for everybody. Right now, I'm speaking, if you will, at the micro level. I'm talking about myself. So 3 factors contributed to my comfort level. First was the availability of a learning management system. And I'll talk about a learning management system a little more in the next slide. So my institution uses a learning management system. It is not enough for an institution to have a learning management system available. It is also important that an individual faculty adopt and use that learning management system. And in my case, it is the case that I use the learning management system quite a bit. Second, my teaching style. It just so happens that I was already teaching in the blended learning format. And again, I'll talk a little bit more about that in the next slide. Third, my students had an early experience in video conferencing in spring semester. Without going into too much detail, it just so happened that on a Friday, I could not go to campus physically, and so my classes were held online. So students had already experienced the video lesson mode. So these 3 factors would become very important both for me and my students going forward. So now let's look at each of these in a little detail. So what is a learning management system? Wikipedia defines a learning management system as a software application for the administration, documentation, tracking, reporting, automation, and delivery of educational courses. And they go on to tell us that the learning management system concept emerged directly from the concept of e-learning. The purpose of a learning management system is to deliver and manage all types of content, including video, courses, and documents. So as I said, my university had already had a learning management system that was available, and I was already using it even before the lockdown, even before COVID-19. So why was I using it? How does using a learning management system help? What you see here on the screen now is a blank course, a course that has not been created yet in the learning management system that we use at my university. It is called Canvas. There are other learning management systems available. The most popular ones in the United States are Blackboard and Moodle. So this is a blank course in a learning management system. As you can see on the left here, there are all these items that can be created within the course, and they can all be housed inside the module. And that's why on the right panel, you have this prompt saying, create a new module. So a module can house any resources that you provide for students, including videos, websites, links, documents, and quizzes. Okay, so that's how a learning management system helps. I like to say it this way: a learning management system is a platform to organize all teaching and learning material in one place. And that's the important thing here. It is all organized in one place, and if the navigation is set right, students can use this as a roadmap and do their lessons. So what is blended learning? I mentioned that my teaching style already happens to be blended learning. So blended learning is a style of education in which students learn via electronic and online media, as well as traditional face-to-face teaching. And the Wikipedia description follows, which is very similar, just different wording. So I happen to use the blended learning format already. So for my undergraduate classes, we have face-to-face classes on campus, but I already used to provide a set of resources for students to use outside of class. And that was my approach even prior to the lockdown. So our traditional classes for the face-to-face teaching, that component, those classes used to meet for 50-minute sessions on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And I used those 50-minute sessions, most of it, for content delivery, to do what traditionally we would have called lectures. So those used to be interactive. So I talk for some time, and then students do problems. They can come up to the whiteboard and do problems and so on. So those were interactive sessions live. And some of those classes used to be for exams, for the students to do the pen and paper part of their exams in class. But I also used electronic and online media. So my philosophy there always was this: the courses that I teach, economics, finance, statistics, these courses are relatively difficult for students. And in fact, pretty early on in my teaching career, students had told me from my math classes how it was easy to do problems when they were doing it with me in the classroom, but when they went back home, the same problem seemed very difficult. So doing practice problems was hard for them. And that's really how I had created my first set of problem-solving videos for my math classes. And so over the years, as Anindita mentioned, this is my 16th year in teaching. So over the years, I adopted, and now I routinely use the blended learning format. I provide resources, I provide videos for students to watch outside of class so that their interaction with me and with the content is not limited to the 50-minute sessions that we have 3 times a week. And those video resources, some of those are videos I record and create, but most of those are resources that I curate from YouTube, watching many, many hours of YouTube videos myself and selecting the ones that match my teaching style, the way I would explain something. So I already put them in the learning management system. My students also do their chapter homeworks and quizzes online. So that was already an online component. Some part of their exams they used to do face-to-face. Now their entire exams had to be online. My students also do projects, especially in my statistics class, the do data projects. They used to do it outside of class, submit it via the learning management system. So there was a significant component that was already online even pre-lockdown. So now let's look at, so how did I use the learning management system for blended learning? Together, they were my comfort factors. So what you are seeing on the screen right now is a screenshot of a module from my course. Earlier, I had showed you a blank module, right? So right now we are looking at chapter one. That's the module in my statistics class. And as you look at the list, you will see that I have a lot of things here and some things I have put in boxes. So as you can see, I provide supplementary videos for my students, supplementary videos for chapter one. And then they have a pre-chapter quiz. There, right here, is the PowerPoint presentation that I use in class and then make it available for them so that in class they don't have to try and write down everything that I'm showing on the slides. They can take minimal notes and then fill it in later. On the panel on the right-hand side, you can see their data project. The instructions are provided online and they submit the data projects online. And the next one is the chapter one quiz. So I highlighted a few things for you to kind of show how this becomes the one place where students look for all resources when they're outside of class, outside those 50-minute sessions. So that's how I use the learning management system for my blended learning approach. So when the lockdown happened, the effect for me and my students was very marginal. So the face-to-face sessions were now replaced with video sessions. I chose to do video sessions instead of doing everything online asynchronous because my objective was to maintain the established class structure and routine. So this was a unique situation that we were faced with. This was a unique, quote unquote, a natural experiment. First 8 weeks, students were coming to class routinely Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and now everything is online. I wanted to maintain that structure that classes will still meet on Monday, Wednesday, Friday for the same 50 minutes, except we will meet via video. So during the sessions, maintaining the interaction was important. I mentioned that in class, my students are encouraged to come up to the whiteboard and work out problems and so on. So to maintain that level of interaction during the video sessions, I used polling for knowledge check. I used the multi-user whiteboard so that they could show us the show me the answers, do matching exercises, tell me what the correct answer is by selecting the correct answer and so on. We used breakout rooms for students to do some group interaction and discussions. And in my senior level classes, my students also did presentations using the same video conferencing mode. So just like here, if some of you were allowed to present, you would bring up your presentation slides and do the presentation. So my students did the presentation same way. So as you can see, the effect was marginal. In class, students would have presented using the computer at the instructor podium. Now they are presenting from their own computers by sharing their own screens. Now the online component, again, very marginal change. They already had, so the first two items you see here, they already had. I showed you the screenshot for that. So a curated set of videos already available online. Projects, homework, quizzes, these are already being done online. Now I put in some additional resources that resulted from our video conferences. And my objective there was to maintain their habit of the self-paced student content interaction, but also to give them a little more. So let's look at what is this little more that I gave them. So this is a repeat of the slide you saw before. This is what they already had. This is one set of new things that students now had. So as you can see in the green box, these are the PowerPoint slides from all the online classes that I did from March 16th to May 1st. You, of course, don't see them all. You see them for two chapters. So what I used to do was during the session, I would use the presentation. I would not make it available before class because I had knowledge check questions in my presentation. I did not want them to see it beforehand, but I would tell them to take minimal notes during the session and they would see the lecture notes later. They could have access to all my PowerPoint slides. So now these are additional resources that they have outside of class. Another additional resource that I now provided them was the recordings for all the live sessions. And let's look at this a little more. Why is it that sharing the recordings was important? So just like in India, some students do not have internet connectivity, and the power or the strength of the internet connection varies from one place to another, the same thing can happen in the United States as well. So during spring break, many students had gone back to their respective states. They had gone back to their homes, to their parents' homes. So while on campus, their Wi-Fi connection, the strength of their Wi-Fi connection is guaranteed because the university has a Wi-Fi that they're all using. But when they go back home, then we don't know what the connection strengths are. In fact, many of my students had problems occasionally logging into the synchronous session and attending the 50-minute sessions. So now by making the recordings available, I'm essentially providing them the opportunity or the opportunity to not fall back on the lessons. So if they got logged out, if they couldn't attend the session to begin with, they could now watch this recording later so that they did not miss class. Many of my students, or at least some of my students, use the app version of the learning management system, and the app version could sometimes run into problems, but later when a computer is available to them, when the recording is available to them, they can now watch the entire session recording, fill in gaps in the notes, in their notes, or listen to the whole lecture. So now they have these additional resources available. So 8 weeks or 7 weeks of classes followed by 8 weeks of final, 8th week of final exam. In most universities, I would like to think in all universities in the United States, students complete a student evaluation or a course evaluation at the end of the semester. And in that evaluation, we ask some free response questions. So because this was an unprecedented situation, we had added questions about the transition. So, and those evaluations we get to see after we have submitted their final grades and so on. So that's just a finer detail. So I was very pleased to see that some of the best comments that I had received from students about the transition was that I had made an easy online transition, that I had done an awesome job of adjusting to online learning, and that I was the most active and creative professor in applying technology and learning an online class. And that was big for me because it was very important for me that their learning experience not be compromised by this sudden switch. So this was the qualitative part of the student feedback. The quantitative part, we added a question about how well, so faculty were allowed to choose synchronous sessions, video sessions, or completely asynchronous online mode. And they changed the questions depending on what they did. So in my course evaluations, the question would be how well did the synchronous sessions work as a substitute for on-campus classes? And what you see here is the results, the responses from students in my finance class. So as you can see, 78.5% of my students said that the video sessions were significantly more effective or somewhat more effective or just as effective as the face-to-face classes. Right? So that was very rewarding, if you will. Not all classes have the same experience. So Dr. Choudhury mentioned about how classes are different, and all of you know math classes are significantly different. So in my statistics class, the student experience was very different. Only 36.3% of students thought the synchronous sessions worked just as well or better than the on-campus classes. So clearly there is something for me to think about looking at fall. maybe for finance, I continue to do what I was doing, but this tells me I have to think about some things differently. So here is one thing I thought about. So in math classes, a lot of work happens on the board. We math teachers do a lot of board work. So here is what I tried with another class in summer. Here is something that we did on Excel. And then I actually wrote onto the Excel sheet to explain what I was doing, how I was writing out the equation, how I was doing the prediction for 2020 and so on. So the details that you see on the screen are not important, but the writing is. So this is something I plan to do in fall. Actually do more of writing, actually do more of board work, because a math class, that is so important. Okay. And I think with this, the micro, my experience is done. And in the interest of time, I'll just keep going. If you have questions, please type them into the chat box for the moderators to tell us after the next speaker is done. So now let's go to a slightly macro level, the institutional experience. So at my institution, we decided to turn this challenge into an opportunity. And again, just do the best we could, given our individual experiences with online teaching, do the best we can to give students the best experience we could. And then leave it to them. They would understand. This was abrupt for us as it was for them. They would have to trust that we were doing the best we could. So at the end of the semester, we did a faculty survey and a complimentary student survey to assess preparedness for this sudden transition, the adjustment that students and faculty, the process of adjustment, how easy or difficult it was, what tools were used. And again, the objective was to draw lessons for future, because the future is uncertain. So we measured preparedness by asking students and faculty how many online classes they had taken. So for students, it was how many they had taken. For faculty, it was how many they had taught prior to this switch. And as you can see, more than 70% of students and 70% of faculty had taught at most 3 classes online before the switch. More faculty than students had taught no classes online. So almost 52% of faculty had not taught any online classes. About 22% of students had taken no online classes prior to the switch. So that would then mean the adjustment could be difficult. And just as expected, over 70% of students said the adjustment was somewhat difficult or very difficult for them. And about 42 or 43% of faculty said the transition or the adjustment was somewhat difficult or very difficult for them. When I talked about my experience, I talked about the tools and strategies that I used. So we had a question on tools that were being used. What I have put in boxes in red are the tools that are typically used in synchronous sessions: polling, whiteboard interaction, and breakout rooms. So let's start with the two bars at the bottom. So as you can see, students and faculty alike reported that a lot of video conferencing was going on, but that a lot of classes also put resources online. So students were seeing a lot of blended learning. But when it comes to the interaction, discussions were very popular. Discussions are what happens in the asynchronous mode. Students can go in and post their discussions when they post their discussion. So that's asynchronous versus the polling, the whiteboard interaction, the breakout rooms. Those are what we use for interaction in synchronous sessions. So we found that not much of that was going on. So as you can expect, students did say that the overall, it seemed like a less interactive experience after the switch. Okay, the lessons that we drew from it, I'll talk about in just a minute. And building it a little higher at the national level, the success of this experiment that we suddenly all found ourselves subjects in this natural experiment, the success of that has some prerequisites. Okay, so access to internet, just like in India, availability of online resources, availability of online tools and technology, and just as important is the availability is how willing are faculty to adopt these online resources, tools, and technology. So I'm aware of at least three surveys that have been conducted at the national level, and I'll bring those up in just a second. But let's say, what were the helping hands that nationally students and educators had? Internet service providers, within days of the lockdown, within days of campuses closing and all teaching and learning going to the online format, internet service providers started providing free or reduced cost service, and they opened Wi-Fi hotspots for public use. Textbook publishers offered access to e-textbooks for free. They also offered access to their online platforms for free. And in the interest of time, I won't spend a lot of time on this right now, but I'm happy to talk about this in the discussion section or the discussion segment. LMS, learning management service providers, they started encouraging faculty who were not using LMSs before, they started encouraging faculty to create courses for free. And a note here is that free individual LMSs had always existed. And most institutions also have an institutionally adopted, the same one institutionally adopted. So national surveys, what did they find? What worked? So here I'll read out, these are quotes from a survey that was conducted by digital, or rather two surveys. They also had a faculty survey and a complimentary student survey. And this, the sources are written in the lower panel of my slide. So as instructors abruptly adapted their in-person courses to be delivered virtually, some more than others incorporated a set of practices widely embraced as contributing to high quality virtual learning. That's what the surveys found. And then they also found that in courses using significant numbers of those practices, both faculty and students alike were more satisfied and more engaged. Another survey, which also talked about what the future holds, this survey found that college students are, or summarized, concluded that college students are savvy customers and most understand the limits of online learning. Despite those reservations, students are open to engaging in online learning activities. In fact, most students believe online learning can be improved through the use of new technologies or tools. And what I'm hoping, what I'm expecting is that by seeing these conclusions from a survey, I hope that what is getting conveyed is that in the United States, the experiences are not uniform across all institutions, across all courses. Okay, there are some institutions, there are some students that said that they believe online learning can be improved. So they clearly did not see the best, right? So it is always a work in progress. There is always a scope for improvement. So looking ahead, my plan for growth, I have already mentioned, so I'll skip that. Let's go to the institutional level. When I talked about the surveys and our findings, I mentioned that we found that the use of interactive tools was very limited. So right now, in fact, this is literally right now, we are holding by faculty, for faculty, training sessions on teaching tools and pedagogy. And we are covering a wide range of topics from using Canvas, that's our learning management system, using tools and features within the learning management system, to creating online exams, to how to use interactive tools for creating engaging lessons. And that brings me to my thoughts on the feasibility of adopting and adapting some of these tools and technologies and strategies for India. So what exactly is feasible? Let's start with adoption of the learning management system. Now, this could be done at the faculty level. This could be done at the institutional level. So faculty can start out by creating their individual accounts for free and set up their courses. Canvas, that's the learning management system we use, that's offered by Instructure.com. And Blackboard is another learning management system, and they offer a free individual account on CourseSites.com. I do not intend for these to come across as, I'm not a spokesperson for Canvas or Blackboard. However, I am a spokesperson, if you will, for the use of learning management systems, because I have found them so helpful. I have been using them for more than a decade now. there are app versions of those available, and I think that would be very, very helpful in the Indian context, because students could use the app versions, and even faculty could use the app versions for quick on-the-go checking emails or checking things that students need, that need immediate attention. I was looking online to see whether learning management systems are popular in India, and I have been talking to my friends who are in higher education in India. So I know that Symbiosis uses Moodle, and some things that I looked online suggested that Moodle is also used at IIT Delhi. It is an open source learning management system. Blended learning, I have to say I agree with Dr. Bashab Choudhury. I actually think blended learning is perfect for the Indian environment. So to repeat or to recap, blended learning is a style of education in which students learn via electronic and online media, as well as traditional face-to-face teaching. So I think that use of a blended learning platform would be especially beneficial for students in India. Faculty could use the learning management system to direct students towards online resources. Some already exist, for example, the Swayamprabha videos. And of course, everyone watches YouTube, so you could use YouTube videos as well. The advantage of the blended learning approach is that students can self-pace their learning. Right? So when you are doing a synchronous session, and I know many of you are, when you're doing a synchronous session, students can get disconnected because of their internet connectivity issues. However, if you have resources available for them to look up online later at their own pace, they can still keep up with the resources and they can do it at their own time. They may have other responsibilities. The internet access may be spotty. They may be sharing their phones, their devices with other members of the family. But when they have the time, they can still continue their education. And I think that's about all I have. In conclusion, I would like to say COVID-19 and the lockdown were unforeseen and unprecedented for higher education everywhere across the world. The unique natural experiment has challenged both providers and receivers of education. I was watching, I was at a conference a few days ago, and someone referred to this as a seismic shift. So we have to look for scalable ways to provide education. In fact, video sessions as a teaching modality emerged out of this lockdown. Earlier, we used to have online learning. We used to have hybrid learning, where some learning happened online and some happened in class, in the physical class. Video conferencing itself has emerged as a new teaching modality. The online platform offers an opportunity to reach students who otherwise cannot attend physical college campuses, right? So in fact, if we can all harness the power of the internet, it may be possible for educational institutions to reach students who otherwise cannot and could not have come to physical campuses. And I think in my concluding statement, I'll say this. So I started out by saying that the fact that so many of you are attending this webinar today reflects the interest you have in understanding the challenges and possible solutions. So in fact, I'll end on that note as well. The fact that we can reach out to so many of you whom I otherwise would not have met, even the organizers at Panihati Mahavidyaloy, whom I have not met in person, but hope to meet in person when I visit Kolkata next time, this would not have been possible. I'm sure some of you could not have attended this conference if it was at Panihati in person. So think about the power of the internet and what we can do if we use it right. And with that, I would like to put some references here and hand it back to the coordinators and the conveners. So back to you, Anindita. And thank you all for your audience.
Thank you, Dr. Roy, for this outstanding presentation. Now, I would like to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Mahananda Kanjilal. Dr. Kanjilal is an associate professor in the Department of Economics, Yogeshchandra Choudhury College, and engaged as visiting faculty in the Department of Commerce, University of Calcutta. Dr. Kanjilal has many papers in several reputed national and international journals and has been attending many national and international seminars as speakers as well as the chairperson.
She presented her works in many international universities, University of Foreign Studies, Tokyo, Japan, Kelenia University, Sri Lanka, Munich University, Germany, etc. are among them. Apart from her excellent academic background, she has a cultural background too. As a reputed international recognized Kathak dancer and successful choreographer, she represented India as educational and cultural ambassador in Germany. Dr. Kanjilal is the recipient of national scholarship from Government of India and is the owner of many awards such as Kala Sridhar Awards, Aditya Awards from Anandabazar Group, Best Kathak Dancer Award, Best Bengali News Readers Award, etc. At present, she gets involved as economic analyst in popular Bengali news channels. Now, I would like to request Dr. Kanjilal to share her views with the audience regarding the impact of lockdown on higher education in India. Over to you, Kanjilal. Dr. Kanjilal.
Thank you, Anindita. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay.
Perfect.
Very good morning. It is a great pleasure for me to be invited in this webinar. I thank to the Department of Economics, Panihati Mahabidyalaya, for giving me this opportunity to speak as a resource person in this international webinar. I thank Dr. Mukti Ganguly, principal of this college, and I feel honored to share this webinar with the Honorable Vice Chancellor, State University, Professor Bashub Chaudhuri. And I'm also happy to share the webinar with a very learned and distinguished Professor of Economics, Dr. Sudipta Roy, Professor of Finance in St. Francis University, Illinois, USA. And thanks to Dr. Anindita Basu Chaudhuri and the total organizing team for making this international webinar. Now, coming to this topic, please give me some time. I'm preparing my presentation. Can you hear me, everybody?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks, Anindita. Now, our topic today. My presentation is visible. Can you see my presentation?
Yes, we can, Mohananda.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Now, the topic today is impact of lockdown on higher education in India and USA. So I'm focusing on impact of lockdown on higher education in India. Now, before going to the impact of lockdown, I would like to mention about the higher education system that we have in our country. Now, we all know that higher education is, of course, a determinant of a country's socioeconomic future. And by the term higher education, we mean the post-secondary plus two level of education and the institutions that provide university degrees or an equivalent may be termed as institutions of higher education. Now, India's higher education system is globally the third largest next to USA and China. Now, what is the structure of this higher education system in India? We know that the courses that are offered in higher education are bachelor's degree, postgraduate degree, MPhil, PhD, DLit, and DSc. And the institutions that provide higher education can be subdivided into this way, like conventional institutions, deemed universities, institutions of national importance, and colleges. Now, we find in India that there are 49 central universities, 367 state universities, 123 deemed universities. Now, deemed universities, they provide high quality specialized education. Like in our country, we have Gandhi Institute of Technology and Management, International Institute of Information Technology. These are deemed universities. With that, we have private universities, 282. And in India, we have 34,908 colleges. We have standalone institutions, which include diploma level technical institutions like polytechnic institutions. Then we have technical institutions like IITs. We have 23 IITs in India. We have 33 agricultural institutions, 24 medical colleges, 17 law universities, and 10 veterinary universities. So this is the situation we have in India, and they provide higher education to the students of a country. Now, according to the survey of MHRD, we find that in 2011, according to 2011 census, we find that 8.51% are graduates in India. And this is 68 million of people. And you know that India is second populated country in the world. So this is just 68 million that are getting graduate degrees in India. And we find that Chandigarh is the state which is getting highest number of graduate students, followed by Delhi, 22%. Now, highest number of colleges are found in the states Uttar Pradesh, Andhra Pradesh, Maharashtra, Karnataka, Rajasthan, and Tamil Nadu. And city-wise, we find that Bangalore has 924 colleges, followed by Jaipur, 544 colleges. Now, if we consider the density of college density, that is number of colleges per lakh students, we find that all India average is 25. And here, Pondicherry or Puducherry, the college density is highest, that is 64. And the lowest figure is found in the state Bihar. In Andhra Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, they have more than 85% of private unaided colleges. And if you consider the enrollment in higher education, we find that it is 28.56 million in India. Now, in undergraduate level, 34% are enrolled in arts, engineering 19%, commerce 14%, and science 12%. So majority students are enrolled in arts, we find. Now, in postgraduate level, we find the maximum students are engaged in management and social science. And in PhD level, maximum students enrolled science stream, followed by engineering and technology. Now, the state with the highest number of enrollment is UP, followed by Maharashtra and Andhra Pradesh. And total number of foreign students in India is 31,632. So this is the scenario, overall scenario of higher education in India. Now, coming to West Bengal, in our state, what is the gross enrollment ratio in West Bengal? It is 18.7% in 2017-18. Now, what is the national average? It is 25.8%. So in West Bengal, we find that gross enrollment ratio is less than national average. And the highest gross enrollment ratio is found in Uttar Pradesh, followed by Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. Now, if you consider the number of colleges per lakh population in West Bengal, at the age group 18 to 23 years, it's 12. Now, national average is 12. And the pupil-teacher ratio in West Bengal is 34, whereas in Karnataka and Kerala, the South Indian states, it's 30. Now, teachers per college in West Bengal is 49, whereas in Tamil Nadu, it's much better, that is 83. In total enrollment of students, West Bengal is among the top 5 states. So it's a very good scenario we find. But West Bengal is the non-preferred choice among foreign students, unfortunately. Now, coming to our topic, that is impact of lockdown in India. Now, coronavirus, we know that, and COVID-19 has created a pandemic throughout the world. And it severely affected not only the health sector, but the overall economy including the education sector, which is also a very large sector in India. And in fact, all the sectors are severely affected due to lockdown. Now, the challenge, what is coming and what is faced by the whole economy is, first of all, in the education sector, in the higher education sector and also the primary education sector, but we will focus on higher education. The challenge is the transformation of the conventional mode of teaching to digital education system. Now, education system actually has forced to adopt online learning and virtual study culture, because we know that online and virtual study culture is existing in India, no doubt, but the widespread use of online learning and the focus and the virtual study culture that we are actually bound to adopt right now in this scenario has become important because of this lockdown. And in UNESCO study, we find that 290 million students across 22 countries are affected due to this COVID pandemic. And in India, around 32 crore students are affected. Now, next we will consider the benefits of this digital education system. Now, each and every system has some beneficial aspect as well as some obstacles. So first we will...
Just 1 minute, Mohanandadi.
Yes.
Font size is very small. In screen, font size is very small. Large. Font size.
Okay, just a minute.
It is not distinct to us. In the screen.
Okay. Please bear me some minutes. Just a minute. Just few minutes.
Madam, please, you pin the Mohanandadi's presentation. You can see a lot.
No. His screen, his font size is small. So
very small. But if you pin the...
Otherwise, okay. Just a minute. She is preparing.
Can you see it right now?
No, same.
Same problem.
Same problem. Do it large or otherwise continue. No problem.
Mohanandadi, if I may suggest, you can just press F5.
F?
You can just press F5. F5.
F5, okay.
Yeah.
Can you see it better?
No. I think it is not working on your computer. Okay, you can
F5.
Just...
Yes, I have done it, but can you see it?
Okay.
It quite
is quite very okay.
It's fine now. It's fine now. It's all right.
Is it okay?
We do not
again.
Madam, please continue.
Shall I continue? Can you see it?
Mohanandadi, that is all right.
Is it okay?
Okay.
Can you continue? Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Okay.
Okay, now coming, sorry for the interruption. Now coming to the benefits of digital education system. First of all, the benefit is that because of the digital the transformation of the education, higher education system into the digitalized way, we find that there will be no loss of studies. The first benefit is there will be no loss of studies and students will become digital friendly. Now, in our country, we have the system of chalk and talk system, that is offline mode teaching that we call. But because of this transformation, the students will automatically will become digital friendly. They will learn how to adopt the online or virtual study system. And the blended learning system that already Professor Bashuk Choudhury and Dr. Sudipta Roy mentioned, here we can introduce this blended learning system where the classroom teaching as well as the online teaching can be adopted by any institution. And I would like to suggest that this blended learning system should continue also, because even after the COVID pandemic, it will pass away. This bad situation will of course pass away after some time. But if we can continue with this system, then of course our higher education system can be improved throughout India. Now, another thing is that new norm of learning management system that already Dr. Sudipta Roy explained. So this is, of course, a new opportunity for Indian education system. We must learn and adopt that system, this LMS system. And another thing is that normally in offline system, how do we study? We prepare something for the classroom and we explain or deliver lecture. And in this system, in online system or digital learning system, actually, the learning material must be improved, because in online system, we have to prepare a learning material. We have to provide that with our students and then we can teach. So the improvement in learning material is, of course, a unique thing in the case of digital learning. And another beneficial thing is that in this virtual study system, collaborative education system will develop. For example, like these webinars we are organizing, we are speaking in these various webinars, we can contact with the resource person, with the teachers from different parts of the country, from different parts of the world. So what do we find? That in this collaborative work, then actually access of lectures of professors will also be available from different states, from different parts of the world, and students of our country can also get benefit of that. So alchemizing education with technology is, of course, a very new thing, and that will give rise to creative learning. And this is a totally a new thing that will be available right now if we can adopt the virtual study system, the digital education system properly. Now, in this creative learning method, for example, medical students can opt for interactive sessions to discuss different case studies with students of several other universities. Engineering students could delve into other streams of engineering like environmental engineering, city planning, other areas. Law students can experience online MOOC sessions. And another thing is that online support groups may be developed to handle the stress, anxiety, fear in such a situation. We all know that students are suffering from tremendous stress, anxiety in our country. So this is very much important. In our country, we always neglect the mental aspect, the mental feedback of the students. Now, this situation, in this COVID pandemic situation, in this lockdown situation, this becomes very, very important. It is the duty of the teachers, it is the duty of us to consider, to face the mental health of the students, their problem, their feedback. And I'm very much happy to know that the system, Dr. Sudipta Roy explained just right now, that the feedback is very much important. And she has done it successfully, how she has taken the survey of the students, and she has been able to understand that how students are responding in this situation. That is very much important.
in our country, what we are focusing that how to technically reach them, that providing the online education system to students through Google Meet, through Zoom and many other platforms. But with that, we also must look after that how they are coping with the situation, how they are getting it. We can be able to reach the students or not. So that in that case, the feedback system is very much important. Coming to the obstacles, we find that the unfortunate situation is that only 45 crore people in India have access to internet and thus e-learning. And we all know that people of rural areas are worst affected, because we know that students, first of all, the students of rural areas, they belong to sometimes very poor families, they belong to lower middle class families, they don't have smartphones, they don't have internet facilities. So even if teachers, college teachers, university teachers are trying to reach them, we are sometimes unable to reach these students. So we must think about this factor, that how we can reach to each and every student of a college, of our institution. So actually, Indian education system is not fully equipped for digital education system. I hope this will take time, but it is necessary to reach and every student. And another obstacle is that because of these students who cannot get access of the internet facility and the class teachings, we are getting many cases of suicide, which is really very unfortunate. As a teacher, I personally feel very sorry for them. And we must, each and every institution should think about this factor, that each and every student is important for us, how we can reach them. We must think about it and we must try some other methods how to reach them. For example, Dr. Sudipta Roy focused that with the online live sessions, we can also record some sessions. We can post these videos, conferences in YouTube, so that later on also they can see the classrooms, they can interact with us. So these options must be available for the students. Now, the obstacles that we are facing is that, first of all, decline in the demand for higher education. Now, we find that a large number of Indian students, second to China, enroll in foreign universities in USA, UK, Australia, China. So many students have now been barred from leaving these countries. So if the situation persists, the decline in the demand for international higher education is expected. This is very unfortunate. Another thing is practical classes. We know that apart from the theory classes, practical classes are very much important in our curriculum, especially for science subjects and many other subjects, in many other subjects like medical students, especially engineering students. So in this situation, practical classes cannot be organized by the colleges and higher education institutions. Next thing is passive learning by students, because students are actually in our country are used to active learning processes. They are familiar with this shock and talk situation, talk and talk learning system. So this online system is totally new for them. So it is a passive learning for these students. Another thing which has been stopped, and the students are facing this problem, this obstacle, that is internship in industries. Because, you know, in many higher education institutions, in engineering, in colleges, in my institution also, we arrange always career counseling, which is done by different companies. They come, they employ our students. So this internships has been stopped recently because of this lockdown situation. Now, laboratory-based research activities are very much affected because our mobility is restricted. Students cannot go there. Their supervisors cannot visit universities regularly. So laboratory-based research activities are affected. MPhil, other research works have slowed down. And we find that decline in the demand for international higher education that already I mentioned. And another important thing is that teachers will have to be prepared for this online education or virtual education system. most of the teachers, many teachers, they are not prepared because they don't actually, this is new to them. So they don't know how to actually reach out to students by which platform they could reach. Now, we can consider the challenges faced by the faculty members of each and every higher education institutions. First of all, academic plans were disrupted. So in each and every year, beginning of our academic session, we plan our curriculum. We actually provide these curriculum to our students. And accordingly, we teach, we take exam, and this kind of thing happens. But here, what do we find? That academic plans are totally disrupted. We have most of the institutions have limited soft and hard infrastructure facilities, limited peer group interaction. Nowadays, after 4 months of lockdown, many institutions, including my institutions, we are trying to organize meetings and all with the online facility, but still in many other institutions, these cannot be done. And another thing is adopting the system of work from home in education. We know that work from home system is available in IT industries and in offices and other industries. But in education, this system is totally new. So teachers will have to adopt the system of work from home, that is teaching from home and reaching out each and every student. That is a challenge faced by the faculty. And another serious thing faced by the teachers of private institutions is that they are facing salary cuts, postponement of increments, even sacking from job and temporary discontinuous. This is discontinuation. This is very unfortunate for the teachers. And as a teacher personally, and I think everybody will also agree with me that we are, of course, meeting the classroom teaching, the physical presence of teaching, interaction with the students, with our colleagues. So that is the challenges faced by the faculty members. Now, the challenges faced by the students. First of all, they are facing tremendously uncertainty and anxious situation. Because first of all, their exams results are delayed. And in our country, we all know that some mid-semesters will, students, they cannot actually decide what to do. They will start the classes for the next semester because they have not been able to sit for the exam for the mid-semesters. So there is an indecision going on. So they are highly confused and uncertainties also among the teaching fraternity. So next, what is faced by the students is adjusting with the digital system, of course. So in our country, like Sudipta mentioned, that in Delhi IIT or any other IIT, like these higher education institutions, they are highly equipped with the digital system of education. But in many higher education systems, in higher education colleges and universities, teachers and students are not very much friendly with this digital system. So suddenly we are facing the situation, we are trying to adjust, we are trying to adopt the digitalized system of education. Another problem is lack of internet facility. I don't know in how many colleges they have full Wi-Fi system or the actually improved internet facility for the teachers and also for the students. Another thing is that admission procedure has become uncertain and delayed because we know that normally we have a particular academic session starting from July to December, then December to the July's May session. This is the normal session that have been started few years back by UGC, but this year the admission procedure will be delayed and we are not sure that when we can start our first semester also. This is another thing, and the joining dates are also delayed. Just now I said when we can start the first semester, we are not sure about it. Now another thing is study abroad plans are also delayed because students cannot they have been not been able to complete their final semesters. So therefore, their plans to take study abroad has become uncertain. Another thing is, of course, the anxiety among the students. They are facing tremendous uncertainty and anxiety about the academic session, about the exam, about the classrooms. And if they actually come to know from their friends that some students are getting the online classes and some are not getting, so of course there is a lot of psychological trauma, psychological depression they are facing, missing their classroom teaching, and of course missing their campus life, which is an inherent part of college life and university life. Now, the challenges faced by the institution is academic, administrative, and financial plans all are disrupted. We are facing that. Important decisions are deferred. And another thing that are faced by the institutions that fees collections are actually not sufficient to for the operation of the managing the working capital, and requirement for the digital platform, which is also very much necessary for each and every institution. This is also lacking in many institutions. Now, next we will consider, I have done a very small survey from the college teachers in and around Kolkata. I got 92 responses from different colleges, and this is the result that the survey, 45.7% associate professors, they have responded, and 42.4% of assistant professors, they have responded in my survey. Now, the question was, has your institution subscribed to any online platform? Now, the result of the survey, we find that only 31.1% of educational, higher education institutions, that is colleges in and around Kolkata, they have subscribed to an online platform, whereas the answer is quite large for the no category, that is 68.9% of the institutions have not been able to subscribe an online platform even after the 4 months of lockdown period. Now, if you consider the online classes taken during this lockdown period from the 93 responses, we find that 1 to 30 classes are taken by 49 teachers, 31 to 60 classes are taken by 19 teachers, 61 to 90 classes are taken by 13 teachers, and more than 91 classes are taken by 5 teachers. And if we consider the study materials delivered during lockdown period, what do we find? That 1 to 30 materials are supplied by 70 teachers, 31 to 60 materials are supplied by 13 teachers, and 61 to 90 materials are supplied by 4 teachers, and more than 90 materials are supplied by only 1 teacher. So this is a very small survey report that I'm projecting to you. And what do we find? In conclusion, I would like to say that, of course, the remote work and remote learning has become a challenge for all higher education institutions. And in this crisis situation, we should think about some new methods, practices about teaching, system of taking examination. And there is no doubt that our system is theoretical and stereotype, and normally it is we use a traditional method of teaching that we adopt normally. So in this situation, normally students study only those portions of the book which is necessary for their examination. They memorize, but actually they cannot involve with the studies or the basic thing about the study material. So this is the drawback of our education system. But actually, the thing is, this is not their fault, because the system of the education we have here, it is the problem of the education system that we cannot get involved the less involvement from the students from the part of the teachers. We must try to develop the online education system where, of course, I think they will be more involved in getting the proper study material and getting adjusted with the new system of education. But
I would like to suggest for the students that during this lockdown period, they are facing uncertainty, anxiety, everything, but they can sign in to an online other programs of skill development, artificial machine learning, data sciences, cybersecurity. There are many online courses available. So without wasting their time when the each and every teacher cannot reach to each and every student, they can also opt for other courses. They can utilize their time, this situation, in this lockdown situation, where they cannot reach to the educational institutions physically. Now, I will give some examples. Like, there are these professional courses are becoming very much popular in other countries. So far, I know that the platform Coursera of USA, during this lockdown period, 2.5 crore students, they have joined for several courses like cybersecurity, data science, artificial intelligence, etc. Now, Google, Microsoft, they are also introducing many online courses. Like Yale University, they have introduced a course, Science of Well-being of Yourself and Others. And 20 lakh students, they have joined for this course, this online course. Johns Hopkins University, USA, they have introduced COVID contact tracing course. Over there, 4 lakh students joined in 1 month for these courses. So there are many other courses like customer service management, financial planning, statistical analysis. So students can use their time with the normal curriculum. They can join these courses, which will help for their future career. Now, of course, I would like to conclude by saying that we should also think about some innovative methods of arranging examination for the students. We have discussed so far about the teaching methodology, online teaching, digital platform teaching, but we should also think about the arrangement of examination for the students, especially the open book method of taking exam, which is prevalent in many advanced countries. We must think about this method also. This technology not only judges the memorizing capacity of the students, but also the thinking capacity of a student. Already I said that in our education system, the students normally memorize the material and for that they prepare for the exam. But the involvement, actual involvement with the studies, the realization of the material is lacking in our students. So if we can successfully introduce the open book system of education, open book system of examination, they automatically will learn how to get involved with the study material and the system. And another thing I would like to mention is that that Dr. Roy already mentioned is that the survey of students is very much necessary. That we are trying to reach the students with online methodology, with online platforms like Google Classroom, Google method of teaching, Google and Zoom, which are very prevalent in our country. But to what extent students can cope up with the situation, how much they are receiving, we must think about this factor. So I would like to conclude by quoting Rabindranath Tagore that in our education system, we have some limitations. And what is that? He said that amader shikkhake amader bahon korilam na. Shikkhake amra bahon koriya cholilam. Meaning education should carry us. We should not carry education. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kanjilal, for this excellent presentation. Finally, this technical session comes to its end. And now I am requesting Ms. Rapti Dev, the faculty of this department, to take over this discussion session. Over to you, Rapti.
Absolutely, their presentations were excellent. And since that, this should go on for a little longer, but we have to abide by time. Surely, this pandemic has made the world stand still, and most governments around the globe have temporarily closed down educational institutions in an attempt to check the spread of this COVID-19. This temporary shutdown has gradually been switching the traditional chalk and chalk classroom to the virtual mode. And UNESCO reports that these nationwide interim closures are impacting over 60% of the world student population. In order to cope up with this unusual state, the e-learning has been getting popular, resisting the students from being detached from education. But this medium has many challenges and limitations. Studies by Dr. Roy and Dr. Kanchilal in USA and India's perspective mainly highlight the alternative ways of e-learning that any institution can adapt and particular policies to make it more accurate and user-friendly. Needless to say, their studies enhance our outlook regarding this matter, and definitely it is a value addition to our knowledge. Already questions have started to come up in the chat box, and I request Professor Obhirup Ghosh to convey the questions from the chat box and from YouTube as well as Facebook Live comment section. Over to you, Professor Ghosh.
Thank you, Rapti. I am Obhirup Ghosh from the Department of English, and I'll take you through this question answer session. And thank you, Dr. Rai and Dr. Kanchilal, for your excellent presentations. You have talked very informatively and at length about the modalities of teaching in the COVID era, the use of new technologies and their prospects, and also the few of the challenges they pose. And you have talked about these things in contexts that are quite different from each other. And I have been keeping an eye on the comment section on YouTube, and the feedback is actually very positive. And I'm sure the participants have benefited a great deal from your presentations. However, there are a few queries, few questions. So what I'll do is I will copy paste those questions here on Google Meet. You can have a look at them. I'll also read out those questions because most of our participants are not on Google Meet. They are on YouTube and Facebook. So here are the questions.
Manandati, just 1 minute. Your screen is on. Your screen is on. Please off your screen.
Oh, my screen is okay.
Screen, till now your screen is on.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Just a minute. So here are two questions that are basically very similar. Joyanto Bachu has asked, only 9% of families in West Bengal can afford computer and internet. How can virtual learning be possible? Monomita Sarkar, and she has a question particularly for Dr. Rai. In India, virtual learning may widen the gap between the haves and have-nots because most of the students belong to rural areas and they have poor net connectivity. What can be done? So I would like to, you know, request Dr. Rai to answer these questions first.
Sure. Thank you very much for those questions. Those are excellent questions. So I have to say, I have thought about that quite a bit. For those of you who can adopt the online learning, is it that you would end up widening the digital divide? Right? That's the question. That is a very difficult dilemma. In fact, right now, if I may share my experience, I already mentioned I have been reaching out to my friends who are in higher education, asking them how they are continuing their teaching and so on. So I think about that. If I were to, for example, convince some of my friends to adopt a learning management system, and so some students could get a better learning experience, while those who do not have internet connections, they would suffer even more. Would I be helping them create a digital divide or widen the digital divide? This is a difficult question to answer, and I think this is exactly where a public-private partnership, this would be one place where that is called for. And I just like I had mentioned, in the US, which obviously is a much more developed country, economically much more superior, if you will, country, even here, everybody does not have access to internet. That's why internet service providers, within days of the lockdown, they started offering their services for free. Is that something that an Indian company could do? I would think so. And even if they could not offer services for free, hopefully this is what will spur them to say, we need to get internet connectivity into the rural areas, because that's how we create the ability of the larger population to access things. Because if you provide, if supply, if you offer something, there will be demand, right? We know it happens both ways in economics. If there is demand, businesses step in. If businesses provide something and consumers see the benefit, they'll take it. So I think among all the different things that COVID-19 has done, I really, really hope that this is something that private businesses are looking at. There is a need to bridge this divide. And this is very important. This time, the COVID-19, the lockdown, everything about it has made it important for us to understand working from home, learning from home. These are important. And internet can be a very powerful enabler, can empower people to do things they couldn't have done. So I hope anyone who is part of corporate or knows someone in corporate, if you can, please spur them into action, is all I can say.
Yes, I would like to share one thing with Sudeep. That is a very good suggestion. That is public-private partnership. This is a very good suggestion. Because we know that in undergraduate colleges, I'm also in universities, of course, in underdeveloped country like ours, we have always shortage of funds. Even if we want to provide the Wi-Fi facility to all the teachers and in most of the colleges, so far, I think in my institution also, we have Wi-Fi in our departmental rooms, in staff rooms, but not throughout the campus. So it's very difficult, but it's necessary. So in this area, if private corporate companies, they come forward to invest in educational institutions, of course, the education system will be enriched, no doubt. Thank you, Sudipta.
Yes, thank you, Mohananda.
Thank you. There is another question from Shreya Vishash. I'll copy the question first.
Can you read out the question, Oviru?
Yes, ma'am. The question is, as you can see, what other activities can we engage the students with, especially higher classes except studies? If there are any other activities that whereby students can be engaged.
Shall I say something?
Yes, of course.
Actually, in my lecture also, I said that there are many other courses that the students can actually take. They can register in these courses. Already I said that there are many courses offered by Google, Microsoft. These companies are offering many online courses in cybersecurity, data science, artificial intelligence. Okay, so apart from their normal curriculum, normal syllabus, if they can register into these courses, short-term courses, actually they will be benefited out of these courses for their future career before going to job, any kind of job. And in this scenario, actually, the world is also changing. The outlook of the job market is also changing. So if normally with the normal curriculum, normal syllabus, BSc, BA, BCom, if they can learn these new courses, that will, of course, help in future activity. Sudipta, can you say something about it?
Yeah, I'll chime in. So if by other, so first let me add to something that Mohananda already mentioned. Mohananda mentioned the courses that are offered on Coursera. Similarly, MIT has for almost a decade, offered a lot of courses for free online in using the open courseware platform. So yes, if they are looking for additional skills, as we're saying, internet has been a very, very, so this is at the information age, right? When I was in college or university and people talked about this as the information age, at that time, internet was just starting out. And I did not fully appreciate why this is information age. And now I understand. You want something, you want to know something, you just type it in, you have information at your fingertips. So if you want to gain some skills outside of your quote-unquote studies, there's ample places to get those. And I'm sure many of you watch YouTube videos to learn something. I do it all the time, right? So that's if you are talking about additional skills. If your question was about students engaging in activities like projects or things like that, those can be done. So I was talking about breakout rooms. So some creative ways in which my colleagues are using breakout rooms is during a session, you send students out into breakout rooms, give them a task. So I, as the teacher, do not have to solve all the problems. So give them a set of problems, tell them, go into your breakout rooms for 10 minutes, work on the problems together, come back. So that improves their critical thinking and problem solving skills so that they learn how to work in groups. They become active learners. They are not always looking to the teacher to provide answers. So there are ways you can build in other skills that the job market requires. So the job market requires knowledge, but it also requires being able to work in groups, being able to do presentations, create things. So you can do all of that.
I would like to share something that is actually in the method of taking examination is actually a great challenge for us, Sudipta, in nowadays. We are actually managing to take online classes somehow, but how to take examination? Mentioned about the open book system that mm-hmm. is prevalent in many countries. I would like to suggest that, especially I can talk about my subject economics, that if suppose in a particular theory we can teach students, but we can give them some case studies to solve so that they can actually think about the material, the topic, about the in-depth study of the main thing of the topic, and they can answer the case studies. We can give the case study and the questions related. So reading the case study, they can answer. And we will, as a teacher, we can understand to what extent they have actually realized the theory or the material. So this is thing, I think this will help a lot for the teachers for organizing the examination system. Sudipta, I have a question for you. Will you please tell me about the examination system that you use in your university also for large-scale examination?
Sure. So I noted that down, the open book exams that you talked about. So I have a comment on that. Sure, the open book exams, the case studies, as you know, we use case studies in our classes for our business courses. Yes. Sure, that will test students' understanding and ability to apply what they learn instead of just checking whether they can memorize things. But I think the question right now that is also facing you is how exactly will submit their case studies? Right. So if it is an open book exam, they can come to class, sit there and do an open book exam. They can come sit in class and do a case study. But right now they have to do it from home. Right. So being able to give them the instructions and for them to submit it, all of that comes together with the learning management system that I was suggesting, that I was saying I use for exactly that reason. So because I use the learning management system, let's say I did not have to email assignments to my students. It is posted in the learning management system. They see it there, they submit it in the Dropbox when they're done, and I grade it within the learning management system. So that brings me to your question, how are we doing large-scale exams? So what within a learning management system, what you can do for my class sizes of 30, you can do for class sizes of 500. Right. So okay. The way I do, so I'll talk about my exams. I like to, because of the subjects I teach, economics, finance, statistics, I like to test their knowledge of the concepts, but I also like to test their ability to apply those concepts. So for testing their knowledge of the concepts, I use multiple choice questions. To test their ability to apply those concepts, I have short answers or problems or something that I'll provide them, which is a real world something that is happening and they have to analyze it. So without meaning to talk about myself too much, one of the case studies that I published in the Journal of Business Cases and Applications is It assesses students' ability to apply their understanding of elasticity, to look at two cases and analyze why in one case the company felt comfortable going ahead with the decision, whereas in the other case the company backtracked on the decision. Right? So things like that. Those can also be set up online. So when you do an exam online, you can have different types of questions. Multiple choice questions can be auto-graded because you can put in the correct answers in the platform and the platform itself can check answers for students. But the essay type, short answer problems, those you have to grade manually. But when you use a learning management system, they're all there in one place. So the organization capabilities that a learning management system offers, that's what makes my task a lot easier. That's what makes it easier for all my colleagues also. Now, when it comes to the larger scale, like the admission to college and so on, those were not held this year in the United States, to the best of my knowledge. So because at the university level and the college level, we do our own end semester exams and so on, those all continued as always. It's just the other exams like college entrance exams or medical college entrance exams, those I think could not be done. And I have not looked at it very much to understand why those couldn't be done online. So maybe you and I can talk about that later.
Actually, in higher education system, we are facing that during lockdown period, schools have actually hurriedly adopted the system. The school classes are going on in much better way than colleges, but colleges and universities are in fact, unfortunately, they are lagging behind. From my survey also, you can find that nearly 70% colleges in and around Calcutta. In fact, Calcutta is a metropolitan city of West Bengal. But unfortunately, over there also, most of the colleges, they don't have the common college platform, online platform for reaching out to students. So, of course, if schools can do it, of course, why not colleges? So,
right. And that's most unfortunate because college students being slightly older, they are actually more suited to understanding and doing the online learning than the schools, younger students.
And the number of students is also less than schools. Right. So if the schools can adopt the facility, why don't we try for colleges, isn't it?
So let's all be agents of change. Let's do this one college at a time, one faculty at a time. Right. So you can all be agents of change. You adopt it. Then students talk about how helpful that was. That's how someone spurs someone else into adopting it. I think that's how you'll have to let it grow. You will have to help it grow organically.
Do you have any question, Abhiru?
Yeah, there is a question from Razia Rafat, which is on a topic different but not entirely unrelated to our discussion here. She asks, do you think the quality and domain of research will be affected due to the use of online methods, as some sections of the economy are not reachable in India?
Perfect question. May I go first on that one?
Yeah, sure, ma'am.
Yeah, so I'll talk about the kind of research I do, which has been impacted by COVID-19. So Anindita had mentioned in her, when she was introducing me, that I happen to be interested in educational research. Now, in educational research, a lot of the things that we do are studying the impact of new teaching tools, strategies, etc., that we adopt. And she mentioned that I am particularly interested in the effect of goal setting as a motivator. Now, for most of these studies, you need a control group and a treatment group, right? So, and typically we repeat these over many semesters so that you know whatever effect you are finding is actually significant. It wasn't just a one-off kind of thing you found. So, and this you all know. So those of you who do research, you know that you have to validate your findings by doing it, by repeating it multiple times. So all those kinds of studies have essentially been tossed out because of COVID-19. Spring 2020 cannot be a control group for any other semester. Fall 2020, the teaching modality will be different from spring 2020. So fall 2020 cannot be a control group for any semester. So all of that kind of research is gone. But other kinds of research emerge. So right now, many journals have put out calls, put out invitations specifically for studies related to COVID-19. On the last slide in my presentation, I had the title of a paper that a colleague of mine and I wrote. So that's the first of, we are hoping, several studies that we will do. So new opportunities emerge. So you say, Razia, do you think the quality and domain of research will be affected due to the use of online methods? Well, that depends on whether you are using online capabilities for collaboration, in which case it will be even better, or whether you are unable to reach some sections, which is what your question seems to suggest. You won't be able to reach certain sections. Well, then depending on what you are studying, sure, then your research may suffer because you do not have a representative sample. So answer is, it depends on the research that is being done.
Dr. Kanchilal, would you like to add to that, the research aspect?
Research, already I mentioned that research has been disrupted because of this lockdown. There is no doubt about it, but we don't have enough facilities for online survey and all. So everything has to be done physically. When we have done our research work also, that has to be done physically, visiting places, casing, taking sample cases. So in this situation, of course, what Sudipta has suggested will be very much helpful if that kind of thing can be done, that survey. And one thing I would like to suggest to students also, that please don't waste your time. You do something constructive. Don't think that this will continue forever. This is just a temporary situation. So, and another thing I would like to mention, and I would like to stress also, that it is the duty of ours also, the duty of a teacher to motivate the students. That is also very much important, because we teachers neglect the mental health of the students. It is the responsibility of all the teachers to motivate our students. This is necessary to encourage them that you do something new, you go to the main studies, with the main studies you do something else. At least personally, I always try to do with that with my students. I think that would be helpful for them.
Right. I'll just add a line to that. Okay, Mohananda, I think that was very well said. And I was talking about this panel discussion that the Indian Economic Association had. So I'll quote, not verbatim, but quote Dr. Sudhanshu Bhushan, who said, yes, we know the studies from the US tell us clearly that online education is not a perfect substitute for in-class education. Yes, we all recognize that. But what's the alternative? The alternative cannot be sitting at home for a year and not, and going back 1 year in education, not studying at all. So yes, the students among you, the teachers among you, please heed Mohananda's call. Please use this time to gain additional skills. Follow along with however your teachers are working very hard to continue the education via their chosen modality of teaching. Remember that we are all in this together. Let's all get out on the other side of this successful, so that we can all celebrate the success. We can all say we went ahead, we succeeded despite COVID-19, instead of our storyline being my life suffered because of COVID-19. Let that not be the story. And that's something I kept telling my students over and over in spring 2020. Let's say we triumphed despite COVID-19. That should be our concluding statement, our storyline.
Thank you, ma'am. There is a question from Sonali Munda. I think you have already answered this question. And she's talking about the psychologically debilitating effects of this lockdown, of this time.
What's the question, Abhirup, exactly?
I'll read out the question. Sonali Munda has asked, in such pandemic situation, how we, the teachers, stay connected to the students and make them involved in study, or try to help them, try to prevent them from suffering from anxiety.
Can I say something?
Of course.
Yes, actually, normally in India, what we are doing in my college also, we are creating WhatsApp groups for the students. So in that way, we can reach them WhatsApp groups are there for each and every honors general sections. We are making WhatsApp groups, and we are interacting with them through that WhatsApp group. We are sending materials by email and WhatsApp groups. That is the option available right now. Shudipta?
Mohananda, that was great. Yeah, the important thing is for the student teachers to maintain connections. And here, of course, you will use whatever technology and thing you have. In India, WhatsApp is very, very popular. So that is a great way to maintain connection with students. In our case, because we have the learning management system and bulk emails through what we refer to as the portal, so that's how we are maintaining our connections with our students. So whatever avenue you have is how you will maintain your connection and motivate them, as Mohananda said, motivate them so that they understand this is temporary. One day this will pass.
Thank you, ma'am. There are two more questions, and they are from our colleagues at Paniyati Mahavidyalaya. Arunoti Dutta from Political Science Department asks, in online teaching, students and teachers miss their teaching and learning environment, respectively. What is your opinion? The physicality of...
Yes, they do. So all our surveys, whether it is in my class, whether it is at the university level, whether it is national level, and in the end, students do say that the online learning experience was less interactive, right? But students also realize that is a limitation. So what can we do? We can just try and make it as interactive as we can. I talked about myself because my students in statistics class thought that the synchronous sessions were not as good. I am trying to make it, to replicate it as much as possible to the physical learning space. I will use the whiteboard more. I will actually write. So things like that is what we can do.
Excuse me, Professor, we are already late, so please end this session.
Thank you, Rapti. We are running behind time, and I believe for Dr. Rai, it's well past midnight. So we will bring this session to an end. Over to you, Anirudha.
Thank you. Your excellent presentation, both of you. It's already late, especially for Dr. Sudipta Roy. Thank you. Now, please.
We also enjoyed very much interacting with all of you and Dr. Sudipta Roy, Professor Bashup Choudhury, Principal Ma'am. It's really a very helpful and enriched. Enriching thing for each and every of us.
Yes. I am also giving thanks to Mohananda Di, Sudipta Di, or Sudipta, and our decision, and all my staffs of Paniyati Mahavidyalaya. Wish to meet you again. Thank you.
Sure. Thank you very much. It was an honor and a privilege. And for all of you in the audience, just like you made this webinar so interactive by typing into the chat box and keeping up the communication, this is exactly how you do it with your students. You hold your Google Meets, your Zoom sessions, and they will interact with you. So with that, thank you very much for the opportunity. And see you all sometime.
Good night for Sudipta.
Yes. Thank you very much. Everyone have a wonderful day.
Good day, everybody, and good night, Sudipta. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Ghosh. Unfortunately, due to time constraint, we are unable to pass on all questions. Kindly note that an auto-generated participation certificate will be sent by email only to those participants who fill up and submit the feedback form. Kindly note that the process of e-certificate generation may take up to 15 days. If you don't receive the certificate within 12 August 2020, only then you may mail us at the mentioned mail ID. The feedback link of feedback form has already been sent in mail, which will become active at 12 noon IST 27 July and will remain active up to 12 noon IST 28 July. Finally, it's the time for vote of thanks, and may I ask Dr. Anindita Basu Chowdhury, the head of this department and the program convener, for imparting vote of thanks. Over to you, madam.
It gives me an immense pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks to those who directly and indirectly contributed to today's webinar. On behalf of the Department of Economics, Panihati Mohabidyalay, I, Dr. Anindita Basu Chowdhury, the convener of today's program, would like to extend my sincere gratitude to all present in this webinar. First of all, I would like to express my profound gratitude to the Principal Madam Dr. Mukti Ganguly for her supportive supervision in this program. I would like to extend my heartfelt gratitude to our respected Vice Chancellor of West Bengal State University, Professor Bashup Chowdhury, for his presence in this webinar and also providing us such encouragement and motivation. I also like to show my sincere gratitude from the core of my heart to our respected President Sir, Dr. Amit Kumar Bishwas. I wish to offer my special thanks to the IQAC coordinator, Dr. Moh Sinha Roy, along with entire IQAC team for their enormous help. I would like to mention my deep sense of appreciation for today's distinguished speakers and also like to acknowledge my heartfelt gratitude to them for making such excellent presentation. I would like to express my special thanks to the members of our technical team, especially Dr. Shubhajit Shaha, Professor Debashish Sarkar, Professor Obhirup Ghosh, and Professor Anupam Das for their constant support and immeasurable help. And also like to wish thanks to this web platform for giving us such wonderful opportunity. I also like express my thanks to the Secretary of our Teachers Council, Professor Amitabh Mondal, for his constant support and inspiration. Last but not least, I would like to extend my special thanks to my beloved colleagues of this department and of other departments for their assistance, support, and guidance. Finally, the audience who have turned up in such great number, which is around 1250, just unbelievable. Thank you so much for your response and cooperation and for being with us. We are ending this program here. If we get such cooperation and support, we will be able to conduct more such program in coming days. Thank you once again. Bye. Bye, thank you.
Like him, wonderful lamb.